Tony's out of town with Princess, and I'm going to fill in for him this morning. So if y'all please stand and join with us as we sing Let There Be Praise. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Sing to the Lord. Give Him the glory. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Forevermore. Let it fill the air. And let there be praise. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Sing to the Lord. Give Him the glory. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Forevermore. Let His love fill the air. And let there be praise. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Sing to the Lord. Give Him the glory. Let there be praise. Let there be joy in our hearts. Forevermore. Let His love fill the air. And let there be praise. Fill the air. And let there be praise. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, y'all. If y'all bow your head as we give reverence to the Lord this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this day, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your home. Lord, I pray for those that are not here this morning for whatever reason. We just ask you to touch them, let them know that they're missed, and bring them back soon. I ask a special touch upon the pastor, Lord, that you give him the words that we need to hear, and that we listen intently, not just hear, but listen. And let that word be embedded in our hearts as we take it out this building tonight, this morning, and then put it in our lives, Lord. And we thank you and give you all the praise, for it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Good morning. How many really meant that? How many said good morning back to me? Okay, I just wondered. Some of you are sitting there looking like, I know it's Labor Day tomorrow, and everybody took off to prepare to labor tomorrow, I'm sure. Right? Someone said, well, the beaches are full and the churches are empty. Hey, you got to go sometimes. Amen. So there's nothing wrong with that. It's good to have you here. Let me bring you up to speed this morning. I appreciate all the people that are filling in and helping out wherever. I appreciate Brother Butch coming and filling in for Brother Tony and some of the others that are filling in gaps where people are out. And everybody needs some time away once in a while. Even Jesus said, come apart or you'll come apart. Amen. So you have to be willing to do just that. And we appreciate our people. And hopefully, and you pray for them as they celebrate their time away and enjoy it. A lot of people online. We have a lot of people need to pray for this morning. But if you're a visitor, maybe you're visiting with us for the first time this morning. If you are, we'd like to give you a visitor's card and then get you, if you would, to fill it out. When you exit the building, the offering plates will be outside on the table. Just drop it over in the vestibule. Drop it over there in the plate and we'll have a record of your visit. We will keep your information here in-house. It will not go out. But if you're visiting this morning and would like to fill out a visitor's card, would you slip your hand up and just hold it up just a minute, and we'll be more than happy. Young lady right here, and it's good to have her with us this morning. Anyone else? I always used to hate to go to church where I was visiting, and I was the only visitor there, and everybody looked at me when I had my hand up. So I just stood up and said, now get a good look and get it over with. Then I'd go sit down. So, okay. All right, but it's a joy to have this young lady visiting with us. And each one of you, it's good to have you back. And I know that, you know, when you come in on holidays and you see a few people and you miss them, isn't it good to be reminded how important they are that you miss them? when you see they're not here and you're concerned about them and you're praying for them. Because some are sick, like Sister Penny Wheat. I know she wanted to be here this morning. She wasn't able to come. And also we need to pray. We have some people that are really going through some very serious circumstance. Brother Danny Heberlin's back in the hospital again and really needs our prayers. Also the family of Sister Rhonda Beagle. Her brother has been diagnosed with liver failure, and they're not able to do anything about it. It's just reached the point, and he's not that old. But it doesn't matter. The age doesn't matter, but it does matter. Pray for him. But by the way, due to this illness, this man's given his life to Jesus Christ. So, you know, whatever God uses to get people to go to heaven, that's a pretty good thing. Amen? But it's a joy to remember to pray for these, and I know there's so many more that need to be prayed for today. Pray for all our people who are not here that are away. They'll have a safe trip back. Pray that my daughter will learn how to duck when softballs come at her. And she's got a black eye. Her husband did not hit her because he's still alive. That's proof. So we know that, but do pray for her. She's had a tough weekend with that thing. And each one of you, you know what? Seeing you here really makes my day a lot of times. You may not know that. And each individual, you're important. There's no such thing as someone who is more important than anyone else. But each one of you have a very special place in my heart and up in my life. Even if you walk in a minute or two late, we love you anyway. So I don't call attention to anybody. Donna, I know I got payback coming, Donna, but that's all right. I love you anyway. So all right, we're going to celebrate the Lord. And by the way, two things today. I hope some of you know we have a very special visitor with us today that was part of us for a long time. Brother Herschel, it's good to have you visiting with us today. Very important. Let's give the Lord a hand. All right. Also, how many know that occasionally we have things that causes us to think, gosh, I'm getting older? Those are terrible things called birthdays. But Miss Jean has one today. And guess I'm not going to tell you how old she is because that's her business. But Sister Jean, we wish you a happy birthday. This is Sister Rhonda's mother. You know, Miss Jean Revels. Listen to me. Reeves. My goodness. Give her a hand. Okay. And most of all, Jesus Christ is here. Let's give him a hand. Amen. All right. Yes. Let me remind you, will not be a service tonight. You will not be having the Bible Institute tonight. We will be back on track, the Lord willing, next Sunday evening. And someone said, well, why in the world did we take off? Most of the people that are in the Bible Institute don't really go. Yes, they do. They go once in a while. They have families, too. And sometime I'll pray that you'll take this weekend and spend it with your family. That's what's so important. So take tomorrow and spend it with your family and enjoy that. Just be reminded of those things that are going on. We'll still be having the Faith Bible study will be up in Havana on Tuesday. We'll be back here Wednesday evening, the Lord willing, and our services will get back on track. But remember to pray one for another and hold each other up to the Lord in prayer. Okay? Are you all ready to continue our song service? This is yes and this is no. That's not complicated, right? Okay. All right, let's all stand. Brother Jerry, let's go do this thing. Let's receive the offering first and then we'll do this thing. I'm sorry. Come on, guys. Somebody's got to keep me on track. Why didn't y'all tell me that? I don't have a mind to make up. One thing, I'm glad I stopped long enough. This is a set of the bylaws and the set for the church. And if you have not read them and signed the paper that comes with them, and you want to be a legal member of the church, then remember you need to do that. Read it. And if you choose not to, you can come as long as you want to. You just won't be able to participate in legal things that we're going to have to deal with coming down the road. Okay? So they're up here. And if you would like, please come by and get one at the end of the service. Brother Gene, pray for us, please.
I'm going to ask you all to stand again, if you would, please, and join with us. There's a new name written down in glory, and guess what? It's mine. Amen. I was once a sinner, but I came, pardon to receive from the Lord. This was freely given, and I found that He always kept His word. There's a new name written down in glory. it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory. And it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. Nothing's forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. I was humbly kneeling at the cross, fearing not but God's angry frown. When the heavens opened and I saw that my name was written down, there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam. In the book 'tis written, saved by grace, all the joy that came to my soul. Now I am forgiven, and I know by the blood I am made whole.
Thank you, Jesus.
There's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. And the white-robed angels sing the story. A sinner has come home. For there's a new name written down in glory, and it's mine. Oh, yes, it's mine. With my sins forgiven, I am bound for heaven, never more to roam.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all remember that touch you got from Jesus? Boy, I do. I was a mess. Of course, my wife still says I am, but that touch from the Lord, it changes you.
He touched me, oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that fills my soul. Something happened, now I know. He touched me and made me shackled by a heavy burden, neath the load of guilt and shame. Then the hand of Jesus touched me, and now I am no longer the same.
Amen.
He touched me, oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know. He touched me and made me whole. Since I met this blessed Savior, since he cleansed and made me whole, I will never cease to praise him. Amen. I'll shout it while eternity rolls.
How about y'all?
He touched me, oh, he touched me, and oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole. Something beautiful happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole.
Thank you, Jesus, for that touch. Amen. You know, I'm so glad that we serve a living God, because in talking with people every now and then, you know, you hear them say, well, I'm really worried about my kids and my grandkids. Well, you know what? We serve a living God, and because He lives, they can face tomorrow. You can face tomorrow. We can face tomorrow because He lives.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives.
Amen, Jesus.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and because He lives, how sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the assurance this child can face uncertain days, because He lives.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's final war with pain.
Amen.
And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory, and I'll know He lives.
Amen.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know
I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lived. And life is worth the living just because He lived.
Amen. You know, it's an amazing thing. One of the greatest things we can do in serving God doesn't require any special talent, gifts. It's called being faithful. Faithful. It's a word that we've lost a lot of in America. And I want to say a couple of things about that this morning. I ask you to pray for the young lady that's in jail this morning because she stood up. Did you hear what I said? She stood up. I realize there's a lot of different opinions about that, but I got to say something. A person that's willing to put their faith on the line, sometimes when it's not convenient, I have to have a certain amount of admiration for. And I pray that you do. And if you don't, then you're going to be challenged. I remember when they told my wife, when she worked for the state, that she couldn't leave her Bible on the desk anymore and she couldn't pass out gospel tracts. Well, needless to say, that just caused her to make sure she did. Not trying to be disobedient to those around her, but there were others in the building with cultic ideas that were passing out theirs. So at least we had a leg to stand on. And the very afternoon that happened, and she came down and was working with us, I was preaching on the Capitol steps, myself and another young man, and her boss man came by and she gave him a gospel tract on the way up the hill. So God, that's amazing how God gets His back. Amen. Pray for the family of the law enforcement officer that we lost this week. My heart breaks for them and many others, and we're at war today. I hate to say that. That's amazing that we're at war with the very people that are around us. Our enemy no more is overseas, and we still have plenty of those, but we also have plenty here that we have to deal with. So we need warriors that are prayer warriors. How many have seen the movie or the film yet called War Room? You may not have, but if you have, you need to. It's by the same guys out of Sherwood Baptist Church in Albany, Georgia. I'm familiar with the pastor there, know him. And those two brothers that do the films, they've done several films. Facing the Giants, Fireproof, and some of the others. And these are the same guys. And their war room is their prayer room. That's where we need to be. We need to be praying for our military, praying for our law enforcement officers, praying for the Church of Jesus Christ, that God will help us stand up and be who we ought to be. Amen. We're back in the book of 1 Timothy. Now, this book is hardly ever taught in a Sunday morning service. And once I get into it, you'll find out why. Because there are a lot of controversial issues that run absolutely, not parallel, but collision course toward the normal church of today. And so when I chose to get into the pastoral epistles, and you guys know the way I teach the Word of God, I go verse by verse, and it doesn't matter what's there, we touch on it, we deal with it. And I love this wonderful three books that are bunched together that we call pastoral epistles because it has to do with the church. It has to do with the way the church is, how the church functions, how it should function, and how it's in error when it doesn't. And listen to me carefully. A church will never have the blessings of God unless it's structured biblically. Did you hear what I said? It will never have the blessings of God unless it's structured biblically. Just like your life and my life, we can never have the blessings of God on our lives unless it's structured biblically. Did you hear me again? It's so important to get that because sometimes when people see, say, well, I think we ought to do things this way or that way, let me tell you what, and I say this in love and just because I love you and as your pastor, but this is the thing we need to use as our guidepost. We don't have anything else. Your idea and is just as good as my idea about doing anything, but none of us can go contrary to the Scriptures and expect to be right. Amen? This is yes and that's no, because when I get into this, you're going to wonder about it, okay? All right, let's pick up in chapter 2, verse 1. Paul is writing to this young preacher named Timothy, who he's left at a church that he actually founded in Ephesus, the church of Ephesus. And he's told him, he said, you stay at Ephesus. I want you to straighten out some of the doctrinal messes that's going on, some of the false doctrine that's being taught. And I want you to teach them the correct way. And so when he gets into chapter 2, verse 1, that's basically what he's about to do. He's exhorting him, earnestly urging him, in some areas that the church had drifted away from. And by the way, we still have a great deal of that today. And that's what this is about. And I know when I cross over certain things and people to say, well, the preacher's just I'm preaching it because it's the Word of God. Now, let me say this, and I say it in love, but if you don't like the Word of God, you won't be happy here. Because I don't have anything else to give you. I really don't. And if I did, I wouldn't. But this is it. This is what we have to live by and to direct the church by. So chapter 2, verse 1, Paul said, writing to Timothy, this young preacher, I exhort or I earnestly urge you, therefore, and the therefore refers back to the last chapter where he's talking about charge that he's given, God's given Paul a charge and Paul has given Timothy the same charge as far as preaching the Word of God. And then he says this, he said, first of all, I want you to pray for people. What he says in verse, beginning in verse 1, he said, first of all, and by the way, this is a primary thing. I'm amazed at people, we spend more time praying for ourselves than we do for other people. And he says here, he says, I want you to pray for, first of all, supplication and prayers and intercession and giving of thanks be made for who? All men. Everybody. Everybody stands in need of prayer. And one of the primary reasons I'm convinced that churches and people have a problem in their spiritual life, and I don't know about you, but I'll guarantee you the devil attacks my prayer life as much as anything in the world. And you may not have that problem. If you do, if you don't, spend that time praying for the preacher who does. But I'll guarantee you, I can be praying and all of a sudden, I'll think of 1,000 things that I need to think about. Y'all have the same problem? You make me feel a little bit better. I guess misery loves company, I reckon. But the idea behind this is we need to be aware that praying is God's ammunition to fill up the hopper for war. That's what we need to have more of on our own lives and the lives of other people. So he said, first of all, supplication. And then, of course, he talks about prayers and intercessions. That's mean filling in for someone or standing between is what it really means. And then giving of thanks, just thanking God for people. Somebody said, well, I got some people I can't thank God for. That's a good thing to start praying about. Is praying that God will give you the grace to be thankful for those people. And then also make sure you pray for all men. Then he singles out some people. And he says, for kings are those in authority. And he continues and he says, for all who are in authority. Now, I got to say something to you. Sometimes it's hard to pray for politicians. We're admonished by the Word of God to do so. And by the way, I don't mean praying that God will kill them. Although sometimes I know you may feel that way, but that's not the way to do it. We are to pray that the will of God be done through these men and these women that are leading our country. And he said, you pray for all of those in authority. And here's why. And maybe this is the reason we have so many problems today. He said, here's why. That we may lead a quiet. That means from outside forces. That we may live a quiet and peaceable life. And the peaceable life is an inner sanction, an inner place of peace. So this is the war coming from the outside, talking to the church, and the war coming from the inside. And if you want to battle with a Christian, just start talking about politics. Don't do that. Don't do that. You're going to get in a problem, and you're going to get in. You know, I know Christians that won't even talk to each other today because they differ in politics. Somebody say, how sad. Listen to me carefully. God's in control of this thing. We may not understand it. We may not agree with it. But I need to tell you, those that are in authority have been ordained of God. Did you hear what I said? That's what the Bible teaches. That's what the Bible says. And I'm going to surrender to them. I'm going to do my very best not to have any civil disobedience unless the law disagrees with the law of God. That's the only time a Christian ever has the right to be disobedient civilly. All the rest of the time, the Bible tells us we're to obey every ordinance of man. Did you hear that? Somebody say amen. The law is here to protect us, although sometimes the people, the laws that are made are not what we think they are, but they're there. So he's telling Timothy, he says, you tell them to hold these people up in prayer. Pray for the kings. Pray for those in authority over us so that we as Christians may live a quiet and peaceable life, and we live that life in all godliness. Boy, that's a lost phrase, isn't it? That's a lost phrase. How do we live a life as a godly Christian? First of all, that means God in control of our lives. And that's the only way godliness happens. It's whenever we surrender our lives. Most of us decide what we're going to do or how are we going to do it instead of letting God already has decided. He's told us what to do. He told us what not to do. And if we want to decide to go do anything anyway, don't expect a quiet and peaceable life. It requires submission. It requires, here's a word, obedience. How many were taught obedience at home? Those that didn't raise your hand, I can tell what kind of person you are. If you weren't taught obedience, my dad had a wonderful way of teaching obedience. Don't do it, boy. That was enough said. He didn't have to tell me why. When a child begins to ask why of people that are in authority, you need to set young man or young lady down, and you don't just have to say because I said so, although there's nothing wrong with that. I think what you need to be able to do is explain maybe why a reason. But now if you're talking to a child who doesn't want to understand to start with, you just let them know, well, even if you don't understand, do it. Amen? There's nothing wrong with being firm and doing it in love. And he's making sure that we understand that. Verse 3, he says, for this, talking about praying for kings, praying for those in authority over us, so that we could live a quiet and a peaceable life. And that would be done in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of the one that matters, God our Savior. Listen to me. You cannot live your life according to my standards. And even if you did, you'd still be in a mess. I can't live my life according to your standards, but every one of us are obligated to live our life according to God's standards. Say amen. And by the way, here's the sad part. This is why we started the Bible Institute here. And listen to me carefully. The reason we did, I believe one of the problems we have in the church today is everybody's depending on the pulpit to tell you what the truth is. You need to be able to do it yourself. You've got a Bible. Find it. And by the way, seminary doesn't teach you the truth. It just tells you how to get the truth. And that's basically what we want to do, is to help you get that. I'm a human being like you are. How many know that I'm fallible? Please don't everybody raise your hand, because you know what? I know what that means. You've been watching me. That's what it is. But here we are. But the Word of God isn't. And that's what he's trying to make sure. He's saying that what we're telling you to do is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of what? Say that again. The truth. Say that again. Truth. By the way, listen to me carefully. Everybody says, well, you know, your truth is different than my truth. So which one is the right truth? That one. That one. Not mine. Not yours. This one. The Word of God. And it's amazing how many people and what and some of the things that we're going to deal with, that Paul's going to deal with, are subjects now that are up in the air all kind of ways. He says this. He said, for there's one God and one mediator, someone that stands between God and men, and that's the man, Christ Jesus. And he's reminding us that we only have one go-between between us and God. And that's not the Pope, and that's not the pastor, and it's not the elders, it's not your wife, it's not your husband, it's Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. He's the one to stand between. He's the one that made the blood flow from his side to the altar to cover the sins of mine and yours who come by faith in Jesus Christ. So he still stands between today. He's still working as a mediator. And he explains it in verse 6. Who gave himself to be a ransom. And you know what the word means. You don't need a lot of illustration there. For all to be testified in due time. Verse 7, he makes it plain. Whereunto? Because of this gospel. Because of this message of what Jesus has done. Then I am ordained to be set apart a preacher and an apostle. Those are two gifts that God gave Paul to use to carry the gospel to the Gentiles. Remember, Paul is considered the apostle to the Gentiles, and the word apostle means sent ones. There was an office of apostle in the New Testament, and those were the 12 men that walked with the Lord Jesus Christ. And of course, after Judas killed himself, that the Bible says, then after he killed himself and went to his own place, and the Bible says there was another person set apart. But Paul called himself an apostle out of due season, which Jesus appeared to him, as you well know, on the road to Damascus. So he saw Christ. That gives him the office of an apostle. And Jesus called him. And then he says, where I am an ordained a preacher and an apostle, and I speak the truth in Christ and lie not, a teacher of the Gentiles in faith. And the word verity means what? Truth. Listen to me. Truth hardly ever flatters. How many know that? I love it sometimes. Preachers, people come up to me and say, preacher, you're looking younger. Now, don't lie. This is church. I got a mirror at the house, okay? I know what that thing says. I've been trying to get my wife to take mine out of my part where I don't have to see it. The point I'm getting at is truth is the only thing, not the person, worth dying for. And if it's worth dying for, it ought to be worth living for. And that's why it's so important that Paul stressed this. In fact, he uses the word truth 11 times in these three little books. He constantly is hammering, truth, Timothy, remind the people that truth, and not your truth, not my truth, but God's truth. And so he says that. He said, listen, I'm teaching the Gentiles in faith and verity. I will, therefore, that men pray everywhere, and boy, this has been misunderstood, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. This isn't a position of prayer. That's not what he's talking about. The phrase lifting up holy hands, did you get the emphasis on holy? It's not on lifting, it's on holy. Are you there? Lifting up holy, it literally is talking about a condition of the heart. It has nothing to do with where your hands are. It has to do with where your heart is. And that's the whole idea. And I know some people say, well, you can't pray unless you lift your hands up. Well, let me tell you what would happen to a person who doesn't have hands? They can pray, right? So you don't have. There's no such thing as a posture in prayer in the Bible. You can pray walking. You can pray running. And if you drive in Tallahassee, you better learn to pray driving. Amen? There's no such thing. In fact, I spend a lot of time driving. Praying, yeah, I do. But then I also, it's a good time to pray, I think. The only thing you got to be careful, if God gives you, all of a sudden you get a hot spot, you know what I'm talking about, God getting talking to you back, and you shut up and listen to him for a while, and you're riding down the roads and tears gets in your eyes and you don't know where you're going, it's a good time to pull over. You can continue to pray. I'm giving you the expectation that nothing you can do physically can help you get in contact with God. Did you hear what I said? If you jump over every pew in this place, the only thing it may do is get you killed, stupid. It's not going to help you spiritually. Amen? So you need to understand, nothing you can do physically, and by the way, I'm not calling any person in here because I've never seen anybody jump over the thing, so I'm not pointing anybody out, but here's what I'm telling you. He's making sure that you make sure your heart is in the right place when you're praying. And that's what we need to understand. Without wrath and doubting, and of course he's talking about here, without any anger and also without any lack of faith. Then he says in verse 9, and he goes right on from the, he's talking about men here in verse 8. See what he said? I would that men would pray everywhere, lifting up. That's not to say that women can't pray, but wait a minute, we're about to get into some things with ladies, so get ready for this one. And he said in verse 9, and like also, in like manner, and he's talking about prayer here, also that women adorn themselves in modest apparel. Oh my God. What are women supposed to wear? Now don't you ask me. I didn't write this book. I'll tell you exactly what Paul said. Modest apparel. Now what does that mean? If you, and this is my opinion, and if you don't agree with it, you got a perfect right to disagree. But modesty has to be in the mind of the person that's standing in the mirror and say, how does God see me? You hear what I said? How does God see me when I dress? And if you're dressing to attract the opposites or anybody from a fleshly manner, That's not modest. According to the Bible. Now, this is not my definition. And if you want to fuss about this, just look at God and say, I wish you hadn't said that. It's not going to change what God does. James, you might want to turn on the lights up there so those people outside can pick up the light. Okay? He's got his thing where he can't hear me. There you go. How about that? There, you said there was light and let there be light. I know the people online, thank you. I know they needed to see a picture of the preacher this morning. My goodness. No, but they need to see what I'm saying and hear what I'm saying both. So modesty is in the mind of the person who's dressing. Christian ladies, I appreciate so much. And by the way, I believe this applies to men too. I believe men ought to be just as modest as women. Amen. And so, do we need to spend any more time here? Good. Okay. I can see a lot of you saying, get going. Okay. But it's important. And he said, in modest apparel. And he said, to do this with shamefacedness, which means choose propriety, do proper about it, and sobriety, and it simply means moderation, and then also not with broided hair. By the way, let me explain why this was so important. Broided hair, so people say, well, sometimes I braid my hair, and that's basically what it meant. But in those days, the prostitutes did that. They broided their hair so they wouldn't get in the way of their work. I'm being very plain, but that was one of the reasons. And he says, if you walk around with broided hair, you look like a prostitute. That's what he was talking about. Now, I know today that's a different thing. But make the application. If you dress like a prostitute, guess what people are going to think you are? Do I need to go any further? By the way, I told you this was not going to be a popular Sunday morning sermon. But it's in the Bible. Just like John 3:16 is in the Bible. And it has just as much authenticity as anything else. So he said, then also, don't do it that way, but, verse 10, do that which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Let good works be our demonstration of being. There's a wonderful, and here, you know, I love to see someone that I can call a lady. Isn't that a word that's almost gotten lost? And what I mean by lady is not somebody that walks around, I don't know how to do it. I can't do it. I'm not supposed to. I'm the other side of that fence, right? But you know what I mean by a lady. A lady acts like a lady, talks like a lady, and she dresses like a lady. And that's basically as a Christian. And we should be able to distinguish. Let me hurry and get this. We should be able to distinguish a man from a woman by the way they dress. By the way they dress. We should be able to. Now, God made you absolutely different in the way you look physically. So we should be able to tell you that. So he says, also, let the woman, let me get that back, verse 10, but which becometh women professing godliness with good works. Let the woman learn in silence with all subjection or submission. Now, let me explain that. That doesn't mean you can't speak in church. We just had a lady share in church, a testimony in church. That doesn't mean that you can't speak at home. It simply means that you're not to be not in submission. When you're not in submission to the Word of God, then you're in charge of whatever it is you want to take charge of. And so he's going to continue to explain it. Listen to what he says. He says, let the woman learn in silence with all subjection. And he's talking about a public setting here because he continues when he says this. But I suffer a woman not to teach, nor to usurp or have authority over the man, but to be in silence. You understand what he meant by silence then? He's talking about teaching, public teaching, and teaching men. The Bible makes it plain that women are to teach women and children. Amen? So we know that's a biblical admonition, that women have that right and that authority. And let me hurry, ladies, and tell you, God isn't making you a second-rate Christian. Do you realize that God let His Son be born to a woman and a man had nothing to do with it? You understand that God isn't making a Christian, a lady, somebody who's to be at somebody's feet. And I know I had a young man in my office. We were doing marriage counseling one day with a young man. And where we got to the part where the wife was to be submission to the own husband, I saw that old boy look over there and kind of cock his head like this. And I thought, you're fixing to get hurt, stupid. You know, you really are. Somebody's going to knock you out. I was trying to explain to this young man that that word has more to do with responsibility than it does authority. It means you have the responsibility of taking care, and you are the one that's responsible for taking care of this little woman you're about to marry. And if you don't feel that way, you need to get rid of him, honey, in a hurry. I'm adding a lot of stuff to what he said here. But it's important. I'm giving you an idea that God never made a woman a secondary individual. She has a wonderful ministry in the church, and she should never, but there's some that she cannot fill. And here's what it says. And it gives us a reason. He said a woman should not be able to teach and or usurp the authority over the man. That means she's not to teach the man. She's not to be in a teaching position in a church over the men. How many understood what I just got through saying? Now, I know some of you sitting back there and say, but so-and-so, you know, does so-and-so. Case closed. Bible says it. And if anyone's doing it irresponsible to the Word of God, I'm sorry. And by the way, there are a lot of good women teachers out there that teach women. Great lady teachers that teach women. But they are not to teach men publicly. How many got what I just said? Now, I know someone said, I just don't like that. I'm sorry, I didn't write this book. I mean, come on, fuss with God about it. And it's true. So he makes it plain, and he says, and he gives us a reason why. Verse 13, 4. And I even had somebody say, well, the reason they did that in Bible times is because women didn't have a chance to get an education. What? Well, I'll tell you why. Here's why. For Adam was first formed and then Eve. And Adam was not deceived. But guess what? Go ahead. But the woman being deceived was in the transgression. She walked up and did exactly what God told her and Adam not to do. How many remember that story pretty well? How many believe that Adam was standing right there when she did it? I do. I may be wrong. God may have to straighten me out when I get to heaven. Let me tell you why. It wasn't Eve's sin that cast us into the sinful state. It was Adam's sin. Because Adam had been the man he should have been, he'd have said, honey, God said, don't do that. He was the head of the wife. And he's using this as a wonderful illustration to show us why the woman is not to teach the man. And he says that she was deceived in the transgression. Verse 15, notwithstanding, she, females, period, shall be saved in childbearing. And there's a definite article before the word childbearing there. And I tend to think he may be talking about, some say that we know he's not talking about Eve bringing forth the Messiah. But I personally believe that. I certainly don't believe any woman is saved just because she has a child. But I do believe the child that Eve is going to bring forth, which would be the Messiah, and the lineage of Eve was going to be what saved all of us, not just the women, but everyone. And you're not saved by doing good things, but you're saved by the one who did the great things. His name is Jesus. And he said that she shall be saved in childbearing if they continue in faith. And faith is the one thing that brings us to Christ. And charity at with holiness and sobriety. Now let me kind of put this together in a bunch so you get a hold of it. He was telling Timothy, there's some rebellion going on in the church. And some people are trying to change the Word of God and trying to place themselves in a position of authority when they shouldn't be. In fact, next chapter is going to give the absolute directions for anyone, any man who's going to be in authority in the church has to meet a very strict criteria. And he's going to get to that in chapter 3. But it's not just what we want to do today. It's what God says. And if anybody in this world has a problem dealing with what God said, then how in the world can they teach the Word of God? Somebody say, what? How? I don't know. I am not going to jump over something just because it raises the hair on the back of your neck. It's in here. And it should be that way. I have people say, well, wait a minute, what if a lady doesn't have a husband? Let me tell you, God's made some wonderful provisions for a woman. Then all of a sudden, she gets a relationship with Christ in a wonderful, wonderful way because then she depends on the Lord more than she would just her husband. And she depends, and of course, as a believing Christian, you depend on both as you have a husband and a wife, a husband, and you have that relationship. But now, I can tell you this, God's going to take care of a woman who doesn't have a husband. He's made every provision in the Word of God for that. But here's what he's been saying. And by the way, we have to make up our mind as a church. I know I've had all kind of people say, well, I just don't see anything wrong with that. Well, let me say this to you. You got two choices, right or wrong. This is right. My opinion is wrong. So is yours. Amen? So If you, and by the way, God isn't telling us something to keep us so we can't do things. God is fixing it so we do it. When we do it right. And we have the blessings of God on our lives. And that's one of the things that we kind of walked away from today, is all of a sudden we decided, listen, I'm not going to be a second person. None of us have a right to stand up before God and tell God one of us are better than somebody else. No, sir. We're all stand level in the need of salvation. Amen. And by the way, when a lady is saved, she's just as saved as any man. In fact, if it hadn't been for godly women, there wouldn't be a church today in America. Did you hear what I said? I mean that. There would not be a church. Can I say this, men, and I love you. Thank God for those of you who are here. I'm not talking to you. I'm talking to those who are somewhere else, I reckon. If men were as faithful to church as women were, it's amazing. You guys say amen out there now. Because you know what happened on Mother's Day? The kids will say, Mama, what do you want to do on Mother's Day? And they'll say, honey, come go to church with me. Right? Ask the daddy. Daddy, what do you want me to do with you today? Let's go hunting. Or fishing. Nothing wrong with hunting and fishing, but there's nothing better than having your family in the house of God. Mama or daddy. So here's what Paul is saying to the church. Timothy, help the church understand that the only way they'll have the blessings of God is being obedient to the Word of God. And church, I want to remind you, no matter what comes down the turnpike, no matter what's said, no matter what the Supreme Court says, no matter what the government in itself says, we'll either have to make up our mind, we're going to do what God said. This is a wonderful illustration because I know this is a controversial issue. But if we aren't going to be willing to deal with controversial issues, then we don't have enough God in us to blow. If we had all of God's power in our life and condensed it down to gasoline, we wouldn't have enough to crank a grasshopper's motor scooter. You know why? It's because we want to have a Burger King religion. We want to do it our way. You can't do that, folks. If you're going to be right, you got to do it the right way. Y'all say amen. And I realize that there's going to be differences of opinion, but that's what this book was given to us for. This settles opinions. And so I have to say, yes, Lord, and teach that, so that we can be right when we need to be right. And gentlemen, if you have a Christian wife, you ought to get on your face and thank God every day that she put up with you. Y'all say amen. And if it wasn't for the grace of God, she'd have left you a long while time ago for a monkey. Well, a monkey'd be obedient. A man's not. No way in the world. So keep this in your mind. If we do it God's way, we have God's blessings. If we don't do it God's way, we won't have. And I'll be honest with you. I refuse to let someone think wrong is right and right is wrong when I have the ability to help somebody. And this does it. It's the only thing that will.